Welcome everybody. My name is Elizabeth Ho and I'm Director of the Bob Hawke Prime Ministerial Centre here at the University of South Australia. I'd like to welcome you tonight on behalf of the University of South Australia and our centre to this very interesting forum on Has South Australia Given Up on Heritage? It's a fairly leading question. I'd like to pay our respects to the Kaurna people on whose land we meet. And I'll just note for those of you who haven't heard me say this that we are deeply indebted to Kaurna elders for their assistance in our gallery on the third level, in advising us about the Kaurna content in that gallery, and the fact that we were made aware of the importance of the red kangaroo dreaming and all that that means. And so when we pay our respects here, we really do deeply feel that it's very important to do so, and that the Kaurna people's love of their land and connection with their land is something that we have to honour and respect. So I always say that in a fairly deeply held way because of the great support that we've had from Kaurna elders. The Hawke Centre, as you may know, offers a year-long program to encourage people, as we put it, to think, connect and act. And particularly in spheres where social responsibility is needed. We work with government, we work with NGOs, charitable groups and community organisations to achieve this. And tonight is no exception, because tonight we have been working with the National Trust of South Australia to provide a community forum. I'd particularly like to thank Professor Norman Etherington, President, and Gail Chalton, Manager, Marketing and Development at the National Trust, for their endeavours towards tonight's program. I'd also like to commend the staff in my team, particularly Louise Carnell, and thank our volunteers, who you probably will have seen in action outside. They're always so important to us and do a wonderful job, so thank you. Many of you may also know that the Hawke Centre is quite pivotally involved in About Time. This is the month-long history festival in our state, and this is just one event of a few where we are drawing attention to the importance of history, where we are celebrating our heritage, and where we hope we are informing and extending other people's knowledge and appreciation of history. We have various details on our website about that, so please go and have a look. And tonight our session is being recorded. A podcast of the event will be available on the Hawke Centre website later this week. We encourage you to bring this to the attention of friends and colleagues who could not be here tonight. We'd also be very grateful if you would switch your phones to silent, because we are recording, but also because it tends to interfere with the flow of things, as we know. Our question policy, we don't like long statements. As we say, we're a centre for democracy. We want as many people to be able to ask questions as possible. So the more that can ask the questions, the freer the dialogue is. So could you bear that in mind? There are a few people that I feel I must acknowledge tonight. There are many people here representing different professions, but particularly heritage professions, local councils, government departments and interested individuals. But in particular, I must thank the Honourable Ian Hunter, MLC Minister for Sustainability, Environment and Conservation, for being here tonight and being part of the panel. Vickie Chapman, Deputy Leader of the Opposition. Rachel Sanderson, State Member for Adelaide. Mark Parnell, MLC Parliamentary Leader of the SA Greens. Kelly Vincent, MLC Dignity for Disability. And a special, special welcome to our patron and former Chancellor of the University, Dr. Basil Hetzel, and the wonderful Anne Hetzel. It is really delightful to have you with us tonight. Thank you. And finally, my colleague, Professor Mads Garbo, who is head of the School of Art, Architecture and Design at UniSA, and that's obviously pertinent to tonight's discussions. Richard Bingham, who is the South Australian Ombudsman, and I'm not sure if she's made it, but I think we should all be very grateful for Margaret Anderson, who is the Chief Executive Officer of History SA, which is running the month-long About Time Festival. I'm now going to hand over to our chair this evening, Norman Etherington. I remember him from a long time ago, so I sometimes go Norm when I should say Norman, so forgive me. Norman is going to give you some background about the topic tonight and then introduce our panel to go forward to our discussion. So thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, I proposed this panel some time ago, responding to the wonderful invitation from the Hawke Centre, and fully intended to enter the list this evening as a combatant. But I find myself the chair of the session, rather than an exponent of the National Trust point of view, and I asked how far I might go in my chairmanship in making an introduction, and I was told that I could ask questions. And so I'm going to ask some questions by way of an introduction before I introduce your speakers. Of course, we can't discuss everything that has to do with heritage. The National Trust has 142 different heritage properties we look after scattered around the state. 42 of them we look after on behalf of the government of South Australia and you. But I'm going to focus my attention on the City of Adelaide, not just because we're here, but because it has been the focus of some high-profile heritage issues in the very recent past, including the Department of Planning and the Minister for Planning not accepting recommendations from the Adelaide City Council for heritage listing, and development plan amendments for the inner suburbs, which earmark certain areas with important heritage values as future corridors of transport and corridors of medium density residential development, and this has caused a lot of community concern. The first question I want to ask with respect to this evening is it true, as has been contended, that the preservation of heritage buildings stands in the way of creating a vibrant, livable city, prevents the city council area from raising the residential population to the 46,000 who lived there in 1912, has been a major obstacle to the planning and realization of major building projects? Well, what did Adelaide look like in 1912? This is one of my own pictures. It's a page from the newspaper, the Adelaide Chronicle in 1916, and it shows you Adelaide from a skyscraper. From the mighty top of the Tattersalls building, you can see in all directions, not a high-rise or even a medium-rise building to be seen, and yet this is the city that housed 46,000 people. Aren't the most vivacious and lively places in our city and in our inner suburbs and even in outer suburbs the places where old buildings cluster and heritage values thrive, as in Lee Street? Not a big major development on the street, but full of life. Gilbert Place, the same. Hutt Street, now earmarked as a major development corridor. Next question. When heritage buildings are knocked over, do we get life-infusing replacements? Here's one. It was on the National Trust watch list back in the 1960s, the Criterion Hotel, right across from the City Hall. It looked like that at the top in 1965. Now, more recently, up to 2006, it's looked like the bottom slide. It was promised to look like this, and it actually looks like this. And if you walk around the corner of the same site, next to the GPO, we're not talking about low-valued territory here, this too has been vacant for many, many years, where heritage values used to thrive. Will you then join me on a virtual tour of other sites where development approvals have erased old buildings where people used to live and work, starting from here, the site of the old Criterion Hotel. That will be our route. And we'll start by nicking over to the corner of Pulteney and Angus Streets. Look in whatever direction you want. From this corner, you see car parks and empty spaces and fenced-in lots. Every one of these different sites was created by a development approval, and on every one of these sites, old buildings used to stand and people used to live there. Coming back to King William Street, south of Victoria Square, we come to the gardens behind the Supreme Court. They've been vacant for decades. My children used to romp there when we went to the central market. The trees and vegetation have grown up. Developments have been suggested, as in the bottom slide, but nothing's happened. Not for decades. Not for decades. Walk down King William Street and keep looking to the west. You're on what I call the Boulevard of Broken Dreams. There's just a little section where La Trattoria stands on one side and these buildings stand on the other. Unfortunately, these buildings, about the only sign of life on the western side, aside from the two pubs, were rejected for listing by the City Council on the grounds that this was a strategic site. Do you think it's a strategic site? And if it's strategic, what's it strategic for? Continue farther on and you get to the magnificent Southgate development. You'll all remember, won't you, when it rose in the middle 1980s and what hopes were held out for it and what promises were made. And next door, we have a catalyst site. The Southgate, wasn't it, to be a catalyst for development? And this catalyst site, for decades, has been a catalyst for I really don't know what. Maybe you do. Continue. Down South Terrace, do these empty sites, empty for decades, enliven their neighborhoods with the promised buildings? Does this site on Gouger Street enliven our city near the Central Market? Will this site ever fulfill its promise? Will this empty space, car park, for 30 years west of Light Square, ever become something? And finally, the gem in the crown. For 50 years, people have been arguing about the clearance of buildings from Centenary Street and on what we now call the Macris site in North Adelaide. 50 years ago, people lived here. 30 years ago, they did business here. For decades now, they've been doing absolutely nothing. So, will the new 30-year plan do for this site what the old ones have failed to do for the last 40? Does this all prove heritage has been an obstacle to populating our vibrant city? Or does it demonstrate the comprehensive failure of the urban planning system since the state took over responsibility? Should we put our future trust in a system that respects the role old buildings play, or continue to believe that development approvals bring development? It's now my great pleasure to welcome and to introduce our first speaker, the minister who is not the minister for planning, but the minister for sustainability and the environment.
And conservation. Thank you very much. Can I also acknowledge the traditional owners of the land, the Kaurna people, and pay our respects to their ongoing relationship with their country. I'd also like to do the traditional politician thing and recognise my friends and colleagues from Parliament, Vickie Chapman on the panel with me tonight, Rachel Sanderson, hi, Mark Parnell, g'day. Vicky, I think Kelly, you're up the back, Kelly Vincent's here with us as well. Of course, my friend and colleague, Anne Levy, former President of the Legislative Council and former Minister. Norm, thank you very much for that question approach to your introductory remarks. I'll do another politician's trick and ignore them all, except for one of them, which where you talked about the size of Adelaide in the 1900s. and the size of Adelaide in the 1900s. I just have to remind you that a large proportion of Adelaide's population were living in slums and tenements in those days, with families of 8 to 12 people living in one bedroom. And the good burghers of Adelaide were very active at the time in lobbying politicians such as Rachel and Vicky and myself about cleaning those slums up and doing something about the rundown accommodation in Adelaide at the time. Sorry, no, Vicky wasn't there at the time. And I'm sure Norman, you didn't personally take some of those photographs. I'm sure that's true. Just a few weeks ago, I saw an article during the rounds on social media from the Chicago Tribune entitled, "In Australia, Urban Perfection is Spelled Adelaide." And every year, our city also features highly in the Economist Livability Survey and other similar studies. And I can't imagine anybody here tonight needs people in faraway places to tell us why Adelaide is such a great place, but it's always nice to have our own prejudices reinforced. By our nature, Adelaideans are very passionate about the future of our city. Some might accuse us of parochialism, or worse, smugness, and maybe. Perhaps we just recognise how fortunate we all are to live in this city. And of course, it's no different in our regions. The heritage and history of towns are cherished and conserved by those locals, from volunteers restoring paddle steamers on the Murray to the recent restoration of Cobb & Co. Coach House at Bimbowrie. Or the extensive history of mining that can be found right across our state in places like Cadena and Moonta, Flinders Ranges and Burra. Through organisations such as the National Trust and many of the community groups that may be represented here tonight, our state heritage is right up there in our social discourse. It's always, it seems, part of our social debate. And for some people, heritage shows us our past and enhances our sense of identity. It might also contribute to community pride and our self-confidence, but it is a link between our past and our future. Heritage boosts certainly our economy through tourism and other ways. It plays a very important role in bringing some visitors to South Australia. And our state heritage is then of great value to us in many different ways. It's integral to developing our cultural landscape and our social identity and our economic prosperity. So, ladies and gentlemen, South Australia has certainly, I don't believe, given up on heritage. I don't think we can. But what I find often left out of the heritage debate, especially when you reduce to a 90-second news grab, if you get 90 seconds these days, it's more like 10 or 12, heritage is not just about the bricks and mortar, certainly not just about the buildings in the CBD. Heritage is also our natural environment. Heritage is our rich and ancient Indigenous culture and the landscape. And heritage is the recognition of the past and future cultural diversity that we call our home. I'd argue that our state's heritage is as much about the stories that we tell ourselves and each other and events that have shaped our society as it is about our built environment. That's why this must be taken into account when we balance the need to protect our history and heritage with the need to develop for the future. Adelaide is a modern city that delivers the structure and services demanded by its citizens, demands that we have this debate. Tough decisions have been made in the past, sometimes not very popular, and tough decisions will be made into the future by this government and the next and future governments of any particular political persuasion. But it's through the wonderful organisations and people that we see engaged in these debates, volunteers who are committed to ensuring our history and heritage is there for future generations to enjoy. It's through them that we can truly ensure that the stories and the history is there for many years to come. As our city continues to evolve and change over the decades ahead, there can be no doubt the stories and events that have shaped us will continue to be the foundation of Adelaide's heritage. And ladies and gentlemen, South Australia has a long and proud tradition of managing and protecting our heritage. More than 2,200 individual places are on the South Australian Heritage Register. From iconic buildings such as the railway station and where I work, Parliament House, to the copper mines at Burra and the old gum tree at Glenelg. There are also 17 state heritage areas across South Australia established through the Development Act. Since March 2002, when the Labor government came to office, the State Heritage Authority and the South Australian Heritage Council have confirmed 81 new entries in the Heritage Register. And during that time, I think they've only removed four. These include the former Bank of New South Wales building on the corner of King William Street and North Terrace, John Dowie's Three Rivers Fountain in Victoria Square, and the Arkaroola region in the Northern Flinders Ranges. A further 25 items, I'm told, have also been provisionally listed on the Heritage Register since 2002. And whilst government has played a key role in these decisions, the fact is these couldn't have been made without the commitment of individuals, communities and organisations have all lobbied and pressured government to recognise these various sites of heritage. And thank you for that reminder. I'll also ignore it, as Norman has led us with. And for that, they deserve our thanks, these heritage heroes, for their efforts at places like Arkaroola will be an enduring legacy. As everyone here this evening would appreciate, I'm sure, managing our heritage also has its challenges. Among them is finding new ways to recognise, value and add meaning to our heritage. And the listing of individual places of heritage significance on the Heritage Register might well protect those places, but it can also be quite a blunt instrument. And we need to find new ways to give life and meaning to our heritage, better ways to engage and connect with our communities, especially young people who will be the future custodians of our heritage. We need to encourage them to embrace our heritage, to value it and want to protect it. We will be committed to working with our communities, heritage professionals and educational institutions to meet the challenges to find these ways forward. And we know that finding answers requires that sort of collective effort. And that collective effort is what we will commit to as a government. We will take communities with us. We will debate issues. We will have those sometimes vehement discussions. But ultimately, it is up to us to make the final decision. But this will enable members of the public to access the information about heritage places, to have those discussions about our stories, and to at least come to the realisation that there are sometimes different views, and those views need to be balanced by those who are making these decisions, be it local government or state government, or indeed private owners of heritage buildings. This is a challenge that's not just faced here, it's faced across the country, it's faced across the world. State government, of course, is supportive of the commercial use and adaptive reuse of our heritage buildings. In fact, I believe that adaptive reuse of our buildings is the way forward. There is nothing worse than seeing a building that is heritage listed and not being used, being let to be run down with no maintenance and no ongoing living, breathing people using that building on a day-to-day basis. I think that will be a failure of heritage. We need to make these things live. We need to make people feel engaged with the buildings that they're living in, working in, or enjoying in other ways. So, ladies and gentlemen, I'm very pleased to be here as part of the debate tonight. I didn't know the rules were quite so slack. I'll know for next time, and I might start the conversation with asking questions as well. Thank you very much.
Vickie Chapman.
Oh, thank you.
Welcome. Yes, I'm going to introduce you. Right. The Deputy Leader of the Opposition and our next speaker. Welcome.
Thank you, Professor. To all of you heritage zealots, welcome. Let me start by saying that in 1836, Jeremiah Cowan came to South Australia with his wife and children. He then promptly died. Very inconvenient for his widow, but his eldest son, Michael, decided that he, at a very young age, would go off to Victoria to try and find gold, which he did. He stashed in the axle of his wagon so it wasn't stolen on the way back. When he returned to Kangaroo Island in South Australia, he built three cottages. He named them Faith, Hope and Charity, and one remains as a legacy today. Not only as a museum of the rich history of South Australia, but of course of Kangaroo Island being the first settlement. Cut a long story short, after breeding like rabbits for generations, I'm the sixth generation of that family, and my grandchildren are eighth. A further disclaimer, I am proudly a member of the National Trust of South Australia, and in addition to thanking you, Elizabeth, for convening this, I thank them for also being a participatory sponsor of this event. I also, of course, welcomed them a few years ago to my electorate, as they now have their new headquarters at Beaumont House. I also, 20 years ago, acquired a heritage building in Victoria Square. They're expensive to maintain heritage buildings, but they're worth it. I am a long-standing patron of Pioneers Associations, and I just want to have that all on the table to start with. I wholeheartedly agree with the Minister that South Australia has not given up on heritage. Regrettably, most of his government have. Let me just give you a brief example. Shortly after I went into the Parliament in 2002, the very first thing I was asked to do by a constituent, who happens to be standing at the back wall, was to ring me up and say, the heritage wall at the Glenside site has been under attack. It was explained to me that the owners of a neighbouring supermarket were backing their trucks into the heritage wall and they were causing significant damage to it. And as the local member, could I make sure this was fixed up? I immediately contacted one of your predecessors, Minister. There have been a lot of them in the last 10 years, but this was the first one that was there when I got there, and sought his support to ensure that the wall was not only remediated at the cost of the offender, but also that it would be protected against future damage or demise. He actually worked, I think, quite diligently after I'd gone off to the press to complain about it, to ensure that it was remedied. And we have obviously vigilantly taken photographs of it regularly in the last 10 years to make sure that it's protected. Thank you, Di, for bringing that to my attention. Since then, after a myriad of different ministers being responsible for that site, overnight one night, after there had been enormous public protest, a building under that side, local council heritage listing, was simply demolished overnight. The bulldozers came in, next day it was gone, some trees with it, buried in the backyard, and the fight was on, let me tell you. I've been fighting for that site ever since. Various ones of your predecessors, Minister, have not been overly helpful. Now, as we know, the nurses' quarters, an excellent building, is again under threat. Now, I just simply use that as one example of where there has been a passion, not just by me, of course, but by the people here in this room, by the people of South Australia, to raise their hand in protest. The tragedy in South Australia is firstly that we're kept in isolation of the value of the built heritage in the state. Secondly, it's often too late to do anything about it. But if we do something about it, it's very late in the piece for the opportunity for the public to raise their concern and present their submission to government in an attempt to persuade them to change their mind or to step in as the Minister has powers to protect on these occasions. I also agree with the Minister on one other thing, and that is adaptive reuse has an important role in what we do in the future. I'm not going to agree with him anymore, let me tell you. There's about enough twice not to do with the Minister in one night. The problem is this. Recently I was debating a bill with Minister Rao, who's the Minister for Planning, amongst other things, and he decided that he was going to impose an increased liability for people who neglected a site, the owners and occupiers of sites who were neglecting a site, would increase... I think from something like $10,000 to $50,000. There was also a current offence for the willful destruction of property, as distinct from a neglect, a failure to provide for the protection of by allowing it to go into decay. And that had a higher penalty. On reflection, actually, the neglect had a $3,000 penalty. So massive increase on the willful neglect, stop the bulldozers coming in. Massive increase up to the same level for neglect. Now, on the face of it, I spoke to some people who were concerned about heritage. On the face of it, that was a good thing. It was going to make people understand that if you did take on the responsibility of a heritage building, that you would be penalised in the same way as if you'd sent the bulldozers in if you allow it to go into decay. Some of those in that you've been paraded tonight in front of may qualify for that. But this actually is the cheap option to make it look like you give a damn about heritage sites. The reality is that when you increase a major punitive disincentive, what it means is that people then sell off that site and they don't progress the development of it, in adaptive reuse in as being a prime example, because they're too damn scared they're going to be prosecuted. So it's a cheap option when governments introduce massive penalties but don't actually change or relax regulation or laws to ensure adaptive reuse can progress. So we see dotted around metropolitan Adelaide many buildings that regrettably sit there decade after decade. and sadly will fall into disrepair. Now, other speakers, I'm sure, will speak about listing systems and ensuring that we have a way of identifying various pieces of built heritage. But can I just mention one other thing? Although the topic is broad, I think clearly it's designed to look at built heritage. What we also fail to do is recognise heritage at a broad level. And certainly the Minister touched on a few, Indigenous heritage, natural heritage and the like. But what we do, unfortunately, is get sucked into accepting, you know, decades of something of more importance. Now, we've just had the decade of the tree. Now, believe me, I own property with thousands of trees. I love trees, you know. I've got a property named after the gum tree. But the position is this. We have gone into overdrive, in my view, in respect of everything to protect a tree. Unless, of course, it's along Port Road, they want to put a tram there, then they can bulldoze down trees and enough to open up a sawmill. But when it suits, we've seen Victoria Square lately. So we've gone through that era. But what I say to you is this. I think, and I think others in South Australia tell me this, that it is important that we recognise back that built heritage is significant. It does need to be protected. It does need to have more than you and I simply out there saying, well, we will make individual commitments to this. It does need money. It does need an absolute desire to ensure that something is done to actually protect it and not just have window dressing by introducing penalties for things that will not deliver on what we have to have. Thank you.
I now welcome to the podium a practicing heritage architect of considerable experience, David Brown.
Good evening. I thought I should follow suit from Ian's greeting all of his colleagues and say hi to all the other heritage advisors who've turned up out there. So I've spotted some of you, Peter from State Heritage, greetings. Kate McDougall's out there somewhere. Andrew Stevens, Andrea is over there too. Simon from Adelaide City Council and Richard Woods is hiding up the back. Hi there, Richard. Okay, really, I've got to do the clicky thing. Thank you. Okay, introductory slide. I want to give you a brief insight into what it is that people like myself do. There are a whole lot of heritage practitioners in Adelaide, probably more than you realise, lots of us beavering away in the background. We are slightly different at BB Architects. We're fairly small. We don't do a lot of government work. Most of our work is private practice, dealing with mums and dads who want to look after their assets or businesses, that sort of thing. So these are my experiences. The other advisors out there run their practices slightly different to how we do, but we all obviously still love and work on heritage properties. Those images are just a little snapshot of things that we play with during the day, some old, some new. So my main roles in life, heritage advisor to councils for 5 years. We, my practice, my business partner and myself, were heritage advisors to Adelaide City Council. We were local heritage advisors only. Council has taken that role internally, and hence Simon Wiedenthofer now fulfills that role along with some other people. I'm currently the heritage advisor for Norwood Council, have been for 4.5 years. And that's a role I really enjoy. Every Wednesday I go to Norwood Council. I have a desk and a computer and they book me appointments with people to visit and talk to about their properties. I provide advice on the assessment of development applications which have an impact on heritage properties. Another role I have, consulting to other architects. So typically if there is development where an architect has no heritage background or experience, they need someone like me to assist them, guide them. We are quite picky about the work we pick up with that. I don't consider myself an advocate in the sense that I'll just stick my hand up for any work. We will only take on work where we agree with the philosophy and the approach of the architect, where they involve us in the design team and actually listen to what we say. So consequently, we don't do a lot of that work. We work in our practice on a lot of conservation and restoration projects. It's probably 50-60% of the business that we do, so fixing up old buildings. That's the fun stuff, getting dirty, talking to people about how to restore stone properly, discovering the history of the building and its significance, and just getting interested and climbing in roofs. And I'll show you some images of some things we're working on. Alterations, additions to heritage places, this is probably the other large part of our work. And again, this is mostly mums and dads fixing up their houses, making them more livable, bringing them into the 21st century. The fairly classic is the four-room cottage, which has a nice old 1970s or 1960s kitchen and lean-to bathroom on the back. We wipe that off, do a contemporary addition. Fairly simple stuff, lots of architects do it, lots of architects do it badly, so we prefer to come along and restore the front part quite faithfully, and then do contemporary work on the back. New buildings in sensitive historic areas, there's not a lot of call for that, unfortunately. We have designed quite a few new smaller buildings in historic conservation zones, and that's something normally we get called in where people run into trouble with council, and so the councils will suggest the names of several heritage architects. They come knocking on our door and say, we want to build a block of flats next to these nice old buildings, can you help us make it look good? And the answer is typically no. If they have the right approach, we will work with them or do the design for them, for smaller sensitive buildings, but unfortunately that's often not the brief. And then the final part of what we do is general contemporary architectural projects. So the occasion arises for nice new houses that are not in a heritage context, and they can be fun as well. Not quite as rewarding because the context isn't there. What I want to talk about is, where does the money come from for fixing up heritage buildings? Now, there are essentially five main areas. Private funding, which is the mums and dads. They're looking after their own house, or it's the hotel owner, or the small business. Typically, there aren't big businesses who spend lots of money on their heritage quite so often. Institutions, so churches, schools, universities. We do quite a lot of work with Adelaide University, and do quite a bit of church work. Local government. So this is where local government's heritage grant schemes, heritage incentive schemes come into play. Adelaide City Council, being the most generous and also having the most heritage places, put up around $1 million a year. I'm thinking that's still the current funding arrangement. Yes. Yep. So we, as a practice, we in the west end of the city, we do quite a bit of work in the city, restoring older buildings, fixing up old verandas, old fences, that sort of work. There are 19 other councils in the state that have much smaller schemes, in typical amounts of $2,000 to $4,000 per applicant. At Norwood, we have $60,000 to $70,000 a year. Excuse me, $60,000 to $70,000 a year available in amounts from $1,500 up to $4,000. So, not a lot of money, but the incentive is there to assist people on the smaller suburban style projects, as opposed to Adelaide City Council, where recently we were working on Catholic Archbishop's House, and Adelaide City Council gave us significant money towards that, over $100,000, which is quite impressive, but then again, the building needed quite an impressive amount of work. The state government funding, there are two main sources of funding from the state government. The Heritage Branch of the Department of Environment, Water and Natural Resources, in the past, used to have quite a significant budget for heritage funding. If we go back many years, they almost had $1 million too, back in the distant past. The last time that fund was run was 2012-2013 financial year, so the money needs to be spent in the current financial year. Typically, the money is offered in January of before the financial year, when you can actually use the money, and there's normally $250,000 available for all the state-listed properties around South Australia. That sounds quite a reasonable sum of money, but there are over 2,000 state listed places, and the maximum funding in the past typically has been around $10,000 at a 50% coverage of your own spend. So far there has been no announcement on ongoing funding from the state government for the heritage branches funding this year. So typically that would have been announced in January and you would be able to spend your money from July 1. So nothing yet. The other part of the state government funding is internal for their own buildings that they own. So there is, within the Department of Planning, Transport and Infrastructure, there's an internal heritage unit and that has a historic buildings conservation fund of around about $1.5 million a year for state government owned buildings. So this is where government departments who have a building can apply to the government to get money to help themselves restore their own building. There are a lot of those buildings and $1.5 million typically doesn't go very far. That's one area of work that we don't focus on. We'll deal with all the other funding people, but we don't deal with Department of Planning, Transport and Infrastructure for internal office political reasons. Federal government funding. In the past, there have been various rounds of funding available. The federal government's always finding more money and handing it out in various ways. The current competitive program, so they run, they'll have a pot of money and basically say you can apply for this pot of money. The people with the best application win, typically. It's currently called Your Community Heritage. There is $8 million over 2 years, with an additional ongoing annual fund of $4.4 million each year, which is called Protecting the National Historic Sites. So that means each year the federal government for all of Australia is putting up $4.42 million for, again, competitive applications. And you look at the recent applications for that and they vary from 10,000 to 15,000 up to the low 100s, which, considering how far they've got to spread that over the entire country, that's probably not a bad thing. I'll go on to some examples of funded works. Now, this is projects that our office has been involved in. This one's a few years old now, Stanley Street. Photo on the left, 1917. Photo in the middle when we were approached to restore it, which is, it's had a fairly sad life. On the right is the mostly restored building. We had problems getting the crow's nest through council and on the top of the building. But we put the mast in just in case that ever changed. Council, curiously enough, were not willing to fund the crow's nest. They would fund the balcony restoration, the repointing, the new front fence, but funnily enough, crow's nest, not really their thing. And I can understand that from mock health and safety issues. All right, moving along. Another one in Sturt Street. Top left is the 50s before it got destroyed. In the middle, some of you may be old enough to remember it when it was painted green. Down the bottom, the final restored product, just recently on the market again, so adaptively reused as somebody's house, footballer and netballer. Our office, west end of the city, 1905, spec-built kind of workers' cottage. We picked that up in 2006, state heritage listed, and with Adelaide City Council's generous funding, they assisted us in making it beautiful again. Current big project we're working on out at Roseworthy, the, as it's now called, College Hall, 1883, first agricultural college in Australia. In 1883, the top two photos are 1883, and it is in the middle of nowhere back then. Still in the middle of nowhere, but it's just surrounded by a university campus. The federal government, under the Your Community Heritage Program, has put forward 50% of the funding for an almost $800,000 project. So currently it is covered in scaffolding and being restored. So there is some good money out there, assuming you can put together a convincing argument as to why your building should get the money. Okay, back to my heritage advisor role. There are two main things that we do, that I do every Wednesday, and I suspect the other advisors do similar things, is advice to property owners. Now that is, in a local council sense, the only type of heritage advisor that still remains in South Australia is a local heritage advisor. I'll get onto that in a minute. So my advice is typically only to local heritage place owners, how to look after their property, how to develop it well, giving them names and phone numbers to call for people who can help them properly, who won't rip them off and who'll assist them with their work. The other part is the advice to the council. So that's assessing development applications that are lodged with council that have impact on heritage places. Let's not have that one up yet. What I would like to say about the heritage advisory role and the comment that it is only local advisory at the moment is probably best summed up by a piece of writing written by Liz Vines in July 2012, shortly following the event where the Heritage Advisory Service, from a state point of view, was cut by the state government, effectively. So I'll just read Liz's words, because it's far easier to do that than it is to summarise. The South Australian Department of Environment, Water and Natural Resources has axed the consultant-based State Heritage Advisory Service as of July 1st, 2012. To achieve a saving of $307,000 per annum, the State Heritage Advisors provided support for heritage owners through free on-site consultation as well as assessing development applications. The service was provided to 42 council areas across South Australia by 9 professional heritage architects and planners. It has been running for over 25 years. It is a core component of state heritage management in South Australia. There are over 2,215 confirmed state heritage owners and many more property owners in the 17 state heritage areas that include Port Adelaide, Burra, Goolwa, Gawler, Harndorf, Colonel Light Gardens, that are also directly affected by this decision. The department has a statutory responsibility to assess state heritage development referrals. Heritage advisors were doing much of this assessment and reporting work. Last year, there were 112 assessments for developments to the value of $108 million in the City of Adelaide alone. All heritage inquiries and applications must now be referred directly to DENA to be processed by the State Heritage Unit, which has 2.8 in-house heritage architects who are already working at capacity. It is inevitable that a backlog will build up and there will be substantial delays to approvals disadvantaging state heritage owners. The South Australian Heritage Council continues to list new state heritage places, but there is now no longer an effective system to support building owners to care for existing state heritage places, let alone new places. Some, but not all, councils have renewed the local heritage contract of the heritage advisor and have agreed to make services available to the state heritage owners, which I must say I'm very happy that Norwood has done. So I now consult, unpaid by the branch, but paid for by Norwood Council, which effectively means it's now your council rates that are paying for the heritage advice to state places rather than your taxes. Back on track. Where were we? Other councils have not yet determined their response. All state heritage advisors have worked closely with state heritage place owners throughout the whole state for over 20 years and are all dedicated and determined in caring for heritage places. In regional South Australia, councils and community groups have also been strong supporters of heritage advisors. As a result of this decision to axe the State Heritage Advisory Service, where there is no local heritage service, the community will be left with no regular heritage advice and conservation service at all. And that is the case in some of the work where we submit in the non-metropolitan councils where there is no heritage advisor. And it's quite difficult for me to approach those councils and get preliminary advice when there is no one to talk to. One other quick quote before I finish. And this is from Pippa Buckbury, another heritage advisor. And this was in her submission to the Civic Trust Awards last year for Brickbat, mind you, not an award. Essentially, again, on the same topic of the ceasing of state heritage advisors. Without this advice, state heritage assets will suffer from longer response times, reduced access to advice by owners, and a rise in inappropriate works, thus degrading their heritage significance. Local councils will also feel the brunt of new demands without an increase in their budget to accommodate them. And associated development will be delayed due to the uncertainty and inevitable public resistance at every step. This is an extraordinarily poor decision by the state government.
Next speaker comes from the world of architecture as well, but also from the world of local government. Councillor Sandy Wilkinson from the Adelaide City Council.
Well, thank you all. Has South Australia given up on heritage from a local point of view, local government point of view? Certainly, I haven't given up on heritage, But I would agree with Vickie Chapman that most of the members of the current state government, in my view, since I've been on the Adelaide City Council, have. And I've had a very disappointing time having run to stand on the City Council in 2007, just after the Criterion Hotel was demolished. And I thought, geez, if the City Council can't protect the Criterion Hotel directly opposite the Town Hall, something seriously awry. And I think I need to get into the political foray to try and fix the situation, much to my frustration, despite my best endeavours to get heritage listing of buildings that most people, not just the zealots in the room, but most of the public would assume are already listed buildings. We've just met with constant, basically, backing of Property Council view that there should be a moratorium on heritage listing. So, I call you all heritage zealots just because Vickie Chapman did ingest, but many people would perceive me as such. But, I mean, here are some examples on the right-hand side of developments that I have designed in my architectural practice for developer clients of mine. On the left is a restoration project. So I'm certainly somebody who designs for developers. 60% of the work that I do and the money that I make is from developers making money out of building stuff. And there's some other examples. And like David Brown, I think the best results can be achieved by a combination of the old and the new. Not the new in lieu of the old, which seems to be the modus operandi that we're seeing in the city, just the new and the new and the new, but the old and the new together. And the top right hand is my own house as a sign of practicing what I preach. And recently I have actually stepped into the dark side and become a developer myself. And this is a development that in Norwood that I'm actually doing, where it's my proverbial on the block doing the development. So I understand the both sides of the development and heritage argument. This was a Easter Monday letters. Heritage is not the enemy of development. I was amazed that the advertiser actually ran this. And thankful that they did, because normally we see articles basically putting forward that heritage is the roadblock, and certainly the Property Council keep repeating the mantra that heritage listing will stifle development of the city, it's the glass dome, and all of that nonsense just gets repeated ad nauseum from the Property Council. But I had a letter in there, and which is... I put there because it's harder to read in the typeface, but I've said there that John Rao, I believe, has listened too much to certain lobbies and lost sight of the fact that you can have development, 30-year growth and heritage. Civilised cities around the world do just that. Even Adelaide has done so in the past. Think of the State Bank building, mid-block, behind retained heritage buildings to the street, and the south side of Grenfell Street as examples. And the State Bank building is the tallest building in Adelaide for those phallus yearners. Adelaide's stone buildings are to Adelaide what the Sydney Harbour is to Sydney. We don't have a Sydney Harbour in Adelaide, but we have a very good stock of beautiful stone buildings, and our government see no value in those other than the Town Hall, the GPO, and the Government House and the Cathedral. And it is those buildings that make Adelaide, Adelaide, and people, the young people, the exodus from Adelaide, people thinking about moving back to Adelaide, they love the stone buildings in Adelaide. That's one of the reasons why they want to come back to Adelaide, because it's such a beautiful city, because it wasn't destroyed like Perth and Brisbane were with the ravages of the 70s. It was by economic default, but you know, we're lucky that by virtue of that economic default, we've actually got quite a lot of of beautiful streetscapes intact. And the recent book that the City Council produced at my instigation with support of see Councillor David Plumridge at the back there, Progressive Adelaide, City Streets, Progressive Adelaide, 75 years on, depicts the streets of Adelaide and shows how they were in 1936 and how they are today. And it's a great book which illustrates just what we've got and what we need to cherish and what the government doesn't cherish. To list just 36, that's 14% of the 251 buildings out of 10,000. You think of the Property Council mantra about putting the glass dome of the city and it'll be the roadblock to development. It's absolutely nonsense. There's 10,000 buildings and they keep repeating, oh, there's 2,000, but that's including all the buildings in North Adelaide. To list just 36 in the CBD out of 251 that were recommended by Donovan and Associates, and that was 251 out of 284 that were originally recommended for townscape listing back in 1992 that the Henry Ninio Council made a political decision not to list where the owners objected, even if it was because of the Taj Mahal. Is scandalous. And it will ensure, this political interference approach will ensure that the heritage debate and uncertainty for property owners goes on and on into the future. Because for so long as political interference in heritage listing goes on and the slashed list resultantly fails to meet the public's expectation of what is and isn't protected in Adelaide, buildings that ordinary people would assume or hope were protected will remain unprotected and people will continue to seek their protection. And this is the thinking that I think, you know, Minister Rao and his predecessor, Paul Holloway, are thinking, oh, we've got the experts, we've got the experts in who'll say that nothing's worth listing, and so we're only going to list 30% of them, and the experts have spoken, and that'll be the end of it. The public just don't accept that. It's nonsense. And we've got situations. I did a walking tour for people in the Hutt Street and South East Corner. I pointed out four houses in Halifax Street. There was a double-fronted sandstone cottage, and then there was a less remarkable Spanish mission house. Then there was a double-fronted bluestone house. Then there was a pair of bluestone masonettes. And I asked the group, which one of those is not listed? And a number of people said, oh, the Spanish mission. I said, none of them. Not one of those buildings is listed. And I think any member of the public looking at those buildings would be at a loss to understand, that was Paul Holloway's decision, that those buildings not be listed. Any member of the public looking at those buildings in Halifax would just assume that they were listed, but they're not. And that's the current situation. So they are, of the 107 buildings that didn't get listed, when only 77 out of 180 in the residential parts of the south of the city got listed. Here's a map which I put together, which shows all of the heritage listing buildings in the city in colours and shows the ones that are listed, that are local listed and that are unlisted and that are demolished. And the bits that have of no heritage consequence at all are white. Now, again, the Property Council says that heritage will block heritage, the development of the city and the achievement of the 30-year plan. Looking at the amount of white on that plan, how could anyone of any sanity suggest that listing the coloured sections of that map will somehow stymie the economic growth of this state? And here's a close-up version. That's Arundel Street, the most one of the most loved cities in the street. Look at all the pink buildings. You would assume that every building in Arundel Street was protected. All of the pink ones aren't. And this was last week. I took a photo this morning but didn't have time to put it on my PowerPoint, but today it is a pile of rubble with a bulldozer on top. That was proposed for listing in 1992. That building was proposed by us for listing in 2007. The government wouldn't agree to list it, and that's what's happened. And you can make your own judgment when you see the new development. So the pendulum was swung to right where the property council would like it to be at the present time. So we've had a plan with no plot ratio in the CBD since the Minister of Capital City was just gazetted, and we have a planning system that has no height limit in the CBD and puts blind faith in a design panel that has no meaningful point of reference at law, because the new development plan is almost devoid of any guidance for new development. I can say that because I'm on the development assessment panel. But this hasn't always been the case, and the 1980s office boom was a period when planners and council decision makers had not given up on heritage as they have today. Far from it, and the following examples demonstrate. This is south side of Grenfell Street. South side of Grenfell Street. Now, here's a building which was demolished. It was a missed opportunity. That's what we got. That's what we could have got. This is my own, I just drew this up in my architectural office, had some of my staff done. It just shows that, hey, you can have your heritage cake and your development cake and eat it too. Harris Scarfs, we lost all of Harris Scarfs, yet this is illustrations that I've shown of how Harris Scarfs could have been drawn in. Instead of having a big concrete box with nice shops but a basically boring box, we could have actually capitalised on what is the point of difference of the CBD. What makes people shop in a CBD, Rundle Mall, rather than going to Westfield Marion? Not another box that looks like it's a Westfield Marion, which is what's just been built, in my humble opinion. They could have done something like this, but they didn't. And again, we proposed that for listing. The government didn't agree to this being listed, hence it was demolished. That's what we got on the left. That's how it could have been on the right. This building here in Weymouth Street was demolished. That's what we got on the left. Again, that could have been incorporated. This is what we had recently built in Hindley Street. That's what was demolished. Again, that could have been incorporated in the development. And that lovely erection there replaced that building, which is probably the closest thing that remained with any reference to anyone that remembers the South Australia Hotel in terms of the balcony. Buildings can be done with setbacks and podiums, but, you know, again, buildings can be incorporated and they can be done behind. You can have the heritage at the front and you can build behind it. You can still have your development and your economic investment in the state. And here's another example. And mid-block is, I think, the way that we should be looking. And this is the way that we can have tall developments in the city. I'm not opposed to tall developments, and this is an example of a mid-block apartment tower which does all the right things because it's mid-block and the two-storey historic buildings to Grote Street are retained. So I thank you for your attendance.
And our last speaker from the National Trust of South Australia and current chair of the Natural Heritage Committee and all-round contributor, Marcus Beresford.
Thank you, Norman. Okay, so I'm the last and lucky speaker. I hope you're all not falling asleep yet. I'm certainly not, because we've had a very stimulating presentation by Sandy. So the first thing I want to look at, rather than answer the question for you, I want you to make up your own mind about whether certain aspects of South Australia have given up on heritage. And I'll start with the current South Australian government. Here at what used to be called the Northfield Infectious Diseases Hospital, we have the original administration block. This, I think, is now called Hampstead Centre. That building is state heritage registered. Unfortunately, it's practically the only building on the entire site that has been protected as a state heritage item. But there was an absolutely enormous complex of buildings on that site, some of them of significant merit, including the old nurse's home. This is a shot of it when demolition began in 2010 because it wasn't protected as a state heritage item, nor for that matter as a local heritage item. And it was quite painful to watch this building disappear It was a very fine structure internally with handsome stairwells, several very handsome stairwells. These shots are taken during the demolition, and I can add that all the floors throughout the entire building were Jarrah. No attempt whatsoever was made to salvage that Jarrah flooring. I understand part of the problem is that it tends to splinter when you remove it if you're not very careful. So a huge amount of waste occurred in the demolition of that complex of buildings. This is Union Hall. You're probably all aware of that masterpiece that has been lost under the state government's watch. In fact, it was state heritage listed. A group of people, including some who are here tonight, nominated it. It was provisionally listed. A very important building designed by the firm of Louis Laybourne Smith. Probably his son-in-law actually did the design, but he had some role in the design. Very fine theatre. It was the absolute ant's pants in its day and had major significance as the theatre which changed Patrick White's writing career from novels to plays. So a very important association with our only Nobel Prize winning writer, that theatre. But as you can see, it was demolished and it's been replaced by a photonics building, which I'm afraid I regard as an architect's fantasy with origami. It's a very strange building in my view. What it replaced had some very interesting detail and lots of integrity still. There was a sculpture by an artist, Baron van der Struik, in the foyer. That's gone, as has all this fine external detail. I'm coming now to a building that hasn't yet gone. I should have mentioned that Union Hall was removed from the State Heritage Register by the then Minister for Heritage, Paul Kiker, in the public interest. Basically, the university lobbied him. They wanted to build a photonics centre, so he agreed and Union Hall was knocked down. Eastwood Lodge, again, achieved State Heritage Registration. And one of our finest buildings of the post-war period. It's an interesting mixture of Art Deco and functionalism. And it's really Adelaide's Isochon. You're thinking, what the hell is Isochon? That is a building in London which is now a tourist attraction and which is very similar indeed to the nurse's home at Glenside Mental Hospital. A building like this could easily be converted into a hotel. In fact, I've stayed in a hotel in Canberra that has undergone a very similar conversion. But it's been removed from the State Heritage Register and will be demolished for open space. It's not going to be replaced by any functional building. It's going to become part of the open space in the Glenside redevelopment so that a lot of the other open space can be turned into office blocks and supermarkets, which, by the way, have gone on hold at this point in time. And I would really urge the Minister to consider, at the very least, postponing any demolition of this building. I mean, it's full of interesting detail. You can see the three-tone linoleum. It's all a bit run down. It hasn't been looked after in the past decade or two, although it was still occupied until quite recently. It's even got some of the original furniture from the when it was nurses' quarters. So it's a building of high integrity and in relatively good condition. And there's a lot of interesting history about it. The the two ministers responsible for its removal from the state heritage are no longer ministers. They either were dumped or stepped down immediately after the building had been removed from the heritage register, which it seems to me an extremely cynical exercise on their part. Here we have the Jade Monkey in Twin Street next to Gay's Arcade at the rear, a very handsome little colonial period building from the 1850s, which was at one stage Balfour's Bakery. It's also been a bookshop and a restaurant, and more recently an entertainment venue for quite a few decades. It was State Heritage listed. Paul Kiker removed it from the State Heritage list because the owner of the site, including a building which fronts Grenfell Street, wanted to build a hotel there, and the site of the Jade Monkey is to become a ground level car park, which will probably house half a dozen cars or something. But that's now gone, as you can see in this picture. Islington Railway Workshops. Here we have a State Heritage registered building, very fine edifice, and there are quite a number of buildings on this site which are State Heritage listed, but there were also a number of very fine buildings on the site which weren't part of the listing. These were the munitions factories built during the war, one of three big complexes. We were the big munitions hub in the war, which I didn't really realise. And the wings of the Beaufort bombers were built in these buildings. They could have been kept in part, instead of which we now have a pretty indifferent Bunnings hardware store. This is a part of the Islington complex which was registered, and unfortunately it is no longer exists. That's an interior shot. The lessee, Genesee Wyoming, demolished it, even though it was provisionally listed, and the legislation is supposed to protect a listed building. I believe, as a lawyer, there was grounds for legal action against the lessee. However, nothing is being done. They've got away with it. Now we come to the question of what will happen to other heritage sites, like the Royal Adelaide Hospital. The National Trust has nominated a whole suite of buildings on that site. We don't yet know what will be listed. I suspect it's going to be another tokenistic exercise. This is the entrance to the IMVS, the original IMVS building of 1936. I mean, superb Art Deco classicism. And look at those beautiful, finely cut granite bollards at the bottom of the steps there. We don't know what the future of a lot of these gems will be. The Eleanor Harrell building, very fine Art Deco style building, actually built in 1954 though. Presumably the plans were drawn up during the war or just before the war, but it went on hold because of wartime restrictions. And I mean, look how splendid it is without the enclosed balconies. I mean, what a splendid apartment block that would make, or maybe even housing for the homeless of Adelaide. There are a whole suite of beautiful stripped classical buildings in that hospital precinct. This is one of them that's unprotected. The one on the corner of Frome Road, the Women's Health Centre, is the only one of these buildings of this style that is protected. That's local heritage listed. The other protected building in the whole complex is the Margaret Graham Nurses Home, which is undoubtedly a superb building. That is State Heritage listed, but nothing else on that site is State Heritage listed. Here we have another registered building, the Murray Bridge Railway Station. another piece of tokenism. Very fine building, and I'm very glad it's State Heritage registered, although it's in a pretty sorry state. I haven't got photos to show you what is actually happening. That is part of a whole complex of a transport hub that dealt with road, river and rail transport. And a huge suite of buildings on that site, including the men's dormitory building, the majority of the site completely unprotected by either state or local heritage listings. There are about half a dozen superb houses, including this gorgeous villa. It's expected that these will be rolled in some redevelopment of this major site, which is right next to the centre of Murray Bridge, completely unprotected. Bells are ringing. Here are some of the train control buildings. Very picturesque, easily restorable. Caramar on Green Hill Road, a registered building. However, the government has advertised it as a prime development opportunity. What does that mean? Does that mean they'll delist it, deregister it? Very fine building with some of its interior detail still intact. These are the Morrison Company curtains which went in when one of our National Trust members lived there in the early part of the 20th century. And a lot of the woodwork still in that building. Local government, I'm going to have to just race through this. Have they given up on heritage? Well, Glenelg Holdfast Bay Council certainly has. They let their Glenelg Ozone go. We did actually nominate that for state heritage listing as well. They weren't interested. Unley Council, they let this building go. I photographed it in the stages of demolition. Easily restorable. That 1970s porch could have been taken off and a front veranda reinstated with the greatest of ease. I mean, there were termites in there as well, but we've all got termites in our house and we get them repaired. Lots of beautiful detail in that house. Look at that tuck pointing on the bluestone down the side and the cut sandstone on the front facade. Gone. Country areas, this is a privately owned building that has been restored. The owner nominated it for state heritage, was told it was a local heritage item. He should go to the local council, which he did. The local council's not interested. They barely have a local heritage list. Indeed, there are many local councils which barely have local lists. Just to make sure that not even the conservationists don't get off the hook. This, of course, is the conservation centre that was in Wakefield Street, sold by the Conservation Council of South Australia without any guarantee that the building would be retained, although it was a purpose-built Art Deco church, one of the very few purpose-built Art Deco buildings in Adelaide. It's been knocked down. It's now a vacant site, and there's a car park constructed on the back of the site, which incorporates a little building in Roper Street, which is local heritage listed. Well, I'm sorry, I just think that's an absolute travesty what they've done. I apologise for the quality of this image. You can see the car park looming above it and this glass enclosure of these two heritage buildings. What an absolute travesty that is. There are all sorts of new reasons to get back into heritage protection. I won't read them through. You can look at them for yourself. There are all sorts of reasons why we need to reform our heritage acts. And they're just a few of the things that should be happening. The ministerial power to delist should be done away with. It's outrageous. We have no comeback at these decisions. That sort of decision should be at the very least accountable to Parliament, but it's not at the moment. And And I mean, I think we need a heritage council that's got a bit of zeal. It doesn't have to be a bunch of zealots. It just needs a bit of zeal to protect our state and local heritage and to start intervening. There should be state ministerial plan amendments to protect local heritage in areas where the councils won't prepare heritage lists. And the Heritage Council should list buildings that are of local significance when the local council won't do it. It's not rocket science, but we also need some citizens' powers for intervention. And I'm talking here about administrative powers. And we know there are powers to intervene in the courts, but everyone knows that's $10,000 a day. And you need a vested interest to embark on that sort of investment. We should have some clear-cut administrative processes where people can intervene. Funding is the last point I want to touch on, because this is a real problem. And I've got a few madcap suggestions there for how we could start to fund the heritage protection industry. Thank you very much for your patience.
We have time for some short, sharp questions, if they are questions, provided there are short, sharp answers. Tim.
City Council, Westminster City Council, worked for Mystic Seaport in the US and a couple of distant states here. I can say without doubt that the management of heritage in South Australia from the government point of view is woefully abysmal. We heard a very rose-tinted story from the Minister, but...
Get to your question.
My question is, what are you going to do about it? Are you going to attempt to benchmark our service in any way? By sending somebody around the world overseas just to another state and have a look how it's done properly. Thank you.
Minister?
Well, I just reject the premise. I don't think you can say we have a woeful approach to heritage in this state. And I'm not going to take up your offer to go on a round the world trip because I don't particularly enjoy travelling. I must be one of the very few politicians, but that's not my bent. But I don't have to go around the world to see what we're doing elsewhere. There are plenty of people in this state who can give us advice from their experience, including obviously you, and who do. And I can say, without any fear of contradiction, that we are passionately committed as a government to our heritage and our state. I reject the earlier characterisation of Minister Rao, because you have to know him to know that he is passionate about heritage. He may not agree with your particular point of view, but that's what the debate is all about. We have to have this public discussion. But I think characterisation of the state's process around heritage as woeful is just wrong.
Next.
The back.
Thank you, Minister, for your comments about the population of Adelaide being a result of people living in slums. It's a very important point that you made. I'd like to ask you what you're going to do to ensure that sites that have been identified for decades as potential World Heritage Sites are put forward. That includes the City of Adelaide parklands and its squares that were identified in the 1990s as having the potential to meet at least three World Heritage criteria, the Nullarbor, Lake Eyre, and I'm sure the list goes on and on and on. That's my first question. My second question is, could you please ensure that political obstruction of heritage is removed from heritage regimes at every level? Because in 2008, an international paper presented to a conference in Ghent on the future of heritage pointed out that Australia's heritage was at risk and in crisis, and the greatest threats to it were the Australian government, the state governments, and local government. Thank you.
Any comment, Minister?
Well, a few. The first point, which I made earlier, about Norman's comment about the population of Adelaide at the turn of the century.
I got that from the Minister.
Yeah, yeah. But, I mean, you do have to understand Adelaide was composed of a lot of working class slums. If you have any idea of the knowledge of the city of Adelaide back in that time, read some of the parliamentary debates and you will have your eyes opened about the quality of life in particularly the west of Adelaide, and the tenements that are occupied. No toilets, no facilities, no kitchens, crowded with working class, or what was called at the time, the underclass. You need to understand that. The Adelaide City Square Mile was chock-a-block. Absolutely, the population was large, but it wasn't in good quality accommodation that you and I want to live in, I've got to say. In terms of your first question about World Heritage listing of certain sites, we'll have more to say to that in the coming months. I'm not going to make those pronouncements tonight, and I'm not going to make judgments on the merit of certain nominations here either. I'll consider those on their merits. But in terms of political obstruction, let me just say this, and I said it during my speech, I'm not going to resile from being a part of a government or being the minister responsible who makes these judgments. There is a process in place. I take advice from government experts. I take advice from community experts. But at the end of the day, I as minister will make certain judgments and I'll make them in the public interest. That is my job.
Thank you.
Yes, I have one question.
Yes.
Advocacy work in Canada, and I must say, to come back to Adelaide to live, I'm really rather shocked. So one thing I learned was get people really focused, and this is a question to each of you, 30-second answer, please. If there was one thing, legislative, aesthetic, economic, educative, that you want to see done in the next 5 years to cure these problems, what would it be?
Well, I think I've already answered that question. I want to see reform of both the Heritage Places Act and the Development Act to put some real teeth into that legislation. I think it's just not working at the moment. It clearly needs a massive overhaul.
Sandy?
There would be very few buildings built before 1920 that most members of the public wouldn't want to see protected into the future. You could make the heritage criteria for local heritage pretty clear by saying if it's pre-1920 and is recoverable, it can be listed.
David?
I think the reinstatement of the State Heritage Advisory Service would be a good start, and I'd agree with Marcus on the legislation changes.
Change the rules to facilitate adaptive reuse so that we don't see vacant buildings just sitting there in decay.
Minister?
Two things. I've already asked my department to report to me about a review of the Heritage Places Act, and I'll be announcing that later on this year. And I'm with Vickie. I would make the ability of businesses, individuals, to reuse buildings and breathe new life into them much, much easier than it currently is.
Ladies and gentlemen, I'm afraid that that's all we have time for. There are many of you in the audience who could speak knowledgeably on the same topic, I'm sure. There's one point that hasn't been made, but before I make it, I want to reveal something because we have a surprise. We revealed this evening the Adelaide City Heritage website. And if you go to www.adelaideheritage.net.au, you will find plenty of interesting information, and the National Trust is proud to be a partner with the Adelaide City Council. They've become our first civic partner. What I want to say finally is that we wouldn't have problems with our governments, state, local or national, on heritage if we hadn't in some ways given up. It's we the people who have not done enough, who've not shouted enough, who've not said enough, and have given the impression that the balance is all one-sided. So please, let's build on what we have, join the National Trust. Thank you all for coming.
Thank you, Vickie. Pleasure.